My name is M. Murali Ram Babu. I am a chemistry faculty. I am going to explain JEE Advanced 2019 Chemistry Paper 1. Question number 1. This question given from metallurgy. It is an inorganic chemistry question. It is a memory related question. The question is related to minerals of some metals. Now, they are given that calamine, malachite, magnetite, cryolite respectively are. Okay, here calamine means it is a zinc carbonate and malachite means it is copper carbonate, copper hydroxide. It is a green color compound. Magnetite. Magnetite is the combination of two oxides. Magnetite. It is Fe3O4, it is a combination of two oxides FeO and Fe2O3. Last one is the cryolite. Cryolite is the Na3AlF6. These minerals are present in option 1, that is why option 1 is correct. It is second question given from the inorganic chemistry qualitative analysis. It is a very good question that is given from the borax bead test. The question given like this: green color produced in borax bead test of chromium 3 salt due to. Now, borax molecular formula Na2B4O7 10H2O. Just it is heated, water of crystallization losing, and then again heated, a glassy mass is obtained. Now, this glassy mass is heated with the boron trioxide. Then this chromium salt combines with the boron trioxide and giving the chromium metaborate. And particularly not mentioning it is an oxidizing flame or reducing flame. In that case, by default you will take it as a oxidizing flame. In oxidizing flame also, hot condition, cold conditions also there. But they are not mentioning at what condition. If not mentioning means you can take it as a cold condition. In the cold condition, it is exhibiting the green color. That green color is due to chromium metaborate that is there in the third option. That is why the correct option for this question is third one. Now we are going to third question. This question given from the organic chemistry. This question is related to strength of carboxylic acids. I think many times in JEE Advanced the questions given from the GOC either related to basic character or otherwise acidic character. Many times they are given. But in this case they are giving that now carboxylic acids, but in this carboxylic acids mostly we can decide based on the pK values. But in general we can say that carboxylic acid in the presence of water converted into carboxylate anion and H plus ion. strength of acid is directly proportional to pK value, or otherwise strength of acid is directly proportional to stability of carboxylate anion. That means what carboxylic acid can give the stable carboxylate anion, that carboxylic acid is stronger one. Here in general way we can take that now, electronegativity of sp carbon is more compared to sp2 carbon, sp2 carbon electronegativity is more compared to sp3 carbon. That means stability of carboxylate anion means here negative charge is there, therefore more electronegativity means that is more stable. However, in this case first two we can decide it easily, acetyl group is there, vinyl group is there. Therefore, acetyl carboxylate anion is more stable compared to vinyl carboxylate anion. Okay, in that way we will clear it now. Carboxylic acid, one is more acidic compared to carboxylic acid 2. But another one is the paramethoxy benzoic acid given. Here paramethoxy means it is electron donating group. Next one is the propanoic acid given. It is also, alkyl group, it is also weaker acid, but very difficult in the case of the methoxy, paramethoxy benzoic acid and propanoic acid, which is stronger acid. That's why in that case we can decide based on the pK values only. That is the reason only at the time of the preparations many times we said to the students also, better to observe the pK values, then easy to find it what is the stronger acid. In that way we will take it here, acetyl acid pK value 1.89, vinyl acid pK value 4.3, paramethoxy benzoic acid 4.5, propanoic acid 4.87. Therefore, pK values gradually increased means acidic strength decreases, that's why option 1 is correct one. Another question given from the physical chemistry, it is a very good question, and sodium stearate, it is a strong electrolyte, and which graph represents micelle formation in the solution. Now molar conductivity and concentration, between that they are drawing the graph and asking that which represents micelle formation in the solution. Okay, we know very well one equation, molar conductivity and concentration, that is molar conductivity at a given concentration equal to molar conductivity at infinite dilution minus A into root C. This indicates molar conductivity at a given concentration is inversely proportional to concentration. We know very well sodium stearate beginning initially it works as a true solution. Initially true solution. That means initially true solution means initially molar conductivity is very high. Now you are increasing the concentration. At certain concentration, micelle formation is observed. Where the micelle formation is observed, at that condition the particles are gathered. That's why that molar conductivity gradually decreases. After micelle formation, still you are increasing the concentration, but molar conductivity here slightly decreases because of gathering of particles of anion, but sodium ions is still available. However, it is slightly decreases after increasing the concentration after formation of the micelle. That is the reason only in this one. Fourth option is the correct one. Remaining options are not correct here because of, you will check it, option 1. Option 1, after formation of the CMC, after formation of the micelle at CMC, they are showing that molar conductivity increases. Practically, it is not possible. In that way, it is eliminated. And whereas, second option, just it is completely against to the first option, in that way it is also eliminated. What about the third option? After formation of the CMC, after formation of the micelle at CMC, they are showing that molar conductivity constantly, molar conductivity is showing as a constant, but practically it is not possible. Reason in that, anions are gathered, what about the sodium ions? That is the reason only practically it is not correct. That is the reason only option 1, 2, 3 are eliminated, option 4 only correct. Another question, another section, that is the second section, more than one option questions. This question given from the biomolecules, it is, I think, basic level question given, just who studied NCERT textbook, I think answering very well. They want true statements. Statement 1, oxidation of glucose with bromine water gives glutamic acid. We can check it, is it right or wrong? Just glucose with bromine water, only aldehyde group is oxidized into carboxylic group. The resultant compound itself is called gluconic acid. In that way, statement 1 is wrong. Coming to the second statement, hydrolysis of sucrose gives dextrorotatory glucose, levorotatory fructose. Now, sucrose on hydrolysis gives glucose and fructose. Glucose itself is a dextrorotatory and fructose itself is the levorotatory. Rotation only decided by experimental result. That's why by study only we will get this statement. In that way, second statement is correct one. Now coming to the third statement. D-glucose cyclic hemiacetal forms are called enomers. We can check it, is it right or wrong? I think you know very well, this D-glucose cyclic acetal forms are represented here. Only first carbon, you will identify that in both the forms. First carbon, H and OH groups are there, and OH group is there on right part, H group is there on left part. That is called alpha form. And another one, OH group is represented on left, H group is represented on right. This is called beta. Remaining carbon atoms configuration not disturbed. Only first carbon, at that carbon only H and OH groups configuration changed. These type of compounds are called enomers. That enomers are named as alpha and beta forms. That's why third statement itself is correct. Coming to the last statement, monosaccharides can't be hydrolyzed to give polyhydroxyaldehydes and ketones. Yes, it is correct. Monosaccharides not undergoing hydrolysis furtherly due to absence of either linkage. Therefore, out of four options, first one only wrong, remaining options are correct. 2, 3, 4. That three options are correct. You will take like this. Another question given in this section from inorganic chemistry. That is, MnO2 reacts with potassium hydroxide in the presence of oxygen, produces the salt W. This salt W in the presence of alkali subjecting to electrolytic oxidation, another salt X is obtained. Now the manganese ions in the W and X respectively represented as Y and Z. Now the correct statements regarding this question. First one, they are given that in both Y and Z, pi bonding occurs between p orbitals of oxygen and d orbitals of manganese. First, we can decide that MnO2 reacts with potassium hydroxide and oxygen, then it gives potassium manganate plus water. Here, potassium manganate is represented as a W. Now, potassium manganate in the presence of alkali subjecting to electrolytic oxidation, it gives potassium permanganate, that is represented as X. Now, the ion containing manganese from the W salt is represented as an Y. The ion obtained from the potassium permanganate containing manganese is the, that is the permanganate ion, that is represented by Z. Now we know very well manganate ion it is a manganate ion, permanganate ion here pi bonds are there between the oxygen and manganese, that pi bonds overlapping from the p orbitals of oxygen and d orbitals of manganese. Therefore, statement 1 is correct. Y and Z, pi bonding occurs between p orbitals of oxygen and d orbitals of manganese. Yes, it is a right statement. And the second one, in acidic solution, Y undergoes disproportion to give Z and MnO2. Y means manganate ion. Manganese oxidation number we know very well. Now it is undergoing the disproportion into permanganate ion and then manganese oxidation number increased and another one, MnO2, they given in the question, here oxidation number of the manganese in the manganate ion decreased. This indicates it is a disproportion reaction. Same element undergoes oxidation as well as a reduction, that indicates it is an disproportion. Here, from the manganate ion, manganese oxidation number increased as well as decreased. What they are given statement, second one, that is correct one. Coming to the third statement, Y and Z are colored and tetrahedral. Yes, you know very well, many times you are using potassium manganate and potassium permanganate, both are colored. Mostly potassium manganate is the green colored and potassium permanganate is violet or purple color. Okay, and it is a tetrahedral. Yes, it is correct. Manganate ion is a tetrahedral as well as permanganate ion also tetrahedral. Therefore, statement 3 also correct one. And coming to the fourth statement, Y is diamagnetic, Z is paramagnetic. Y means manganate ion, here D1 configuration is there and whereas permanganate ion, it is a D0 configuration is there, but they are given that Y is diamagnetic, they are given. Y means manganate ion. Manganate ion contains one unpaired electron. What they are given, that statement is wrong. While Z is paramagnetic given, Z means permanganate ion. Permanganate ion contains 0 unpaired electrons, means D0 configuration. That means it is diamagnetic. But they are given in reverse order. That's why statement 4 is wrong. Finally, we conclude that 1, 2, 3 statements only correct. Last statement is wrong. Another question given in this section from organic chemistry. Beginning one molecular formula they are given. That is the C6H10O, it is added by methyl magnesium bromide and followed by water, Q compound is obtained and it is allowed to react with the concentrated HCl, S major compound is obtained, Q again in another reaction allowed to react with the 20% of phosphoric acid, then R major compound is obtained, R is allowed to react with the HBr in the presence of peroxide, U major product is obtained, R again in another reaction allowed to react with the hydrogen in the presence of nickel followed by bromine in the presence of light. Another compound, that is the major compound T, is obtained. As per the given molecular formula, I think it is matching with the this general formula. Mostly CN, this general formula CnH2n-2O, it is matching with the this general formula. As per this general formula, here total 4 hydrogens short compared to saturated compound. I think here one pi bond, one cyclic ring, or 2 pi bonds present or 2 cyclic rings are present, like this only we are expecting. Now in this one, based on the this given general formula, I can expect it is an a cyclic carbonyl compound. That cyclic carbonyl compound, I will take it as an A cyclohexanone. One thing just observe that in this, all options are there related to cyclic compounds only. Okay, that is the reason only I can take that cyclic carbonyl compound in this way. Now, this cyclic carbonyl compound is allowed to react with the alkyl magnesium halide, and it is a good nucleophile as well as base. Now, here carbonyl compound is available means it is giving the nucleophilic addition reaction, that is why alcohol is obtained. Here alcohol is obtained. It is a tertiary alcohol. That compound itself is named as a Q. Now, this Q compound is allowed to react with the concentrated HCl. I think it is this reaction just similar to Lucas reagent. Stable carbocation is formed here. That is why you are getting this S compound. Tertiary alcohol converted into this tertiary alkyl halide, that is the major compound is the S, just like the Lucas reagent. Okay, coming to the another reaction with the Q, that is the phosphoric acid, everyone knowing alcohols undergoing the dehydration at that conditions. Everyone knowing alcohol mostly proceeding through even mechanism because of it is conducted in the presence of acid. Really, OH group is a bad leaving group, we know very well, but it is protonated in the presence of acid, later it is relieved easily in the way of water. Okay, as per even mechanism, we will get the major product, that is the alkene, and this alkene is represented as a R. Now, this alkene major product is the SageF product. Now, this alkene R is allowed to react with the HBr in the presence of peroxide. Everyone knowing HBr can, in the presence of peroxide, it can proceed through the free radical addition reaction. It gives the anti-Marconi's product. That's why, and bromine attacks where the anti-Marconi's product we are getting it now, where the more number of hydrogens, that's why U is the major product is this one. Now coming to the R again, in another reaction, now hydrogen in the presence of nickel, everyone knowing it is a normal addition reaction. And this addition reaction gives the methyl cyclohexane is obtained. Now this methyl cyclohexane is allowed to react with the bromine in the presence of UV light. Everyone knowing this is a normal regular reaction, that is the free radical replacement reaction, and stable radical is obtained at the tertiary carbon. That is why bromine attacks at a tertiary carbon, the major product is this T is represented like this. Okay, anyhow we completing the here products what obtained. Now we want to check it, what they are given options, and as per that options we are getting that products or not, we will cross check it. In that case, we are coming to the option 1, and here S compound they are given, this S compound S correctly we are getting it now, this S is matched with that, that is why S is okay in the option 1. And coming to the compound U also coincide, that is why option one is correct one. Coming to the option two. Option two, U compound. Yes, U compound matched here. That's why it is correct. And T compound. Yes, T compound also matched here. That's why second option also correct. Coming to the third option. In that third option, U compound. U compound, what given in the third option? What we are getting as per the reactions not matched. That's why option 3 is wrong. Coming to the last option, that is the compound S. Compound S not matched what we got it in the reactions. That's why last option also wrong. Finally, only two options are correct, that is 1 and 2 in this one. Okay, another question in the section 2, that means more than one option questions. It is given from the physical chemistry, that is thermochemistry. That is the question itself is the standard enthalpy of reaction equal to standard enthalpy of formation. The correct option is. Okay, different options they are given here. We want to cross check it. First of all, we want to learn what is the meaning of standard enthalpy of formation. That means one mole of compound produced from its constituent elements in their standard states. That means only one mole of the compound obtained from its elements only. Here reactants and products must be present in their standard states. What is the meaning of standard state? Here standard state means mostly stable state, or otherwise it is also called as a reference state. At what conditions of pressure and temperature it is defined? Pressure you will take it as 1 bar pressure. Temperature, any temperature you are taken, mostly 298 kelvins of temperature. Now how you can decide that is a standard state or not? Okay, coming to the options and we will check it. Here sulfur they are given, Sa2 solid. I think sulfur is available in different allotropic forms. Among them, rhombic sulfur is the stable state for the sulfur. That's why rhombic sulfur is taken as a standard state. Okay, particularly temperature they are not mentioned, means you are taking that 298 kelvins of temperature. At 298 kelvins of temperature, rhombic sulfur is stable. That's why you are assuming that it is present in the standard state. Oxygen standard state, that is the gas available as a O2. That's why it is also available in the standard state. SO2, sulfur dioxide, that is also available in the standard state, that is the gas. And one more thing now, one mole of the compound only we want it. That's why here one mole of the compound obtained from its elements all being in standard states. That's why option 1 is correct. Okay, it is only just checking as per the statement. Coming to the second one. Here hydrogen standard state gas, yes, it is there given. Oxygen standard state also gas given. Water standard state is also liquid. Okay, all being in their standard states. But a small problem is there. What we are given here? One mole of the compound given. But here you are getting 2 moles. That is the reason only. Don't take this option as a correct one. It is the wrong option. Coming to the third option, standard state of oxygen is O2, already we completing the statement, and O3 also standard state is the gas, 1 mole of the gas obtained from its element, element means here O2 only. That is why here all are present in standard states and 1 mole of ozone is obtained, that is why it is also correct one. Coming to the last statement, last option, this last option I think carbon given, hydrogen, no? Ethane. Okay, ethane 1 mole only obtained, it is a gas, no problem. And hydrogen, okay, standard state. Coming to the carbon, carbon also exhibiting allotropy. Now standard state of carbon is the graphite, but they are given here gas. That is the reason only, don't take the last option. Reason, the standard state of the carbon is the graphite. That's why only don't take the last option. Okay. Finally, we conclude that first option and third option only correct options here. Okay, another question in this section. This question is related to inorganic chemistry. Very good question they are given. And here a tin chloride Q, named as a Q, undergoes following reactions. Reactions not balanced. Q plus Cl minus gives X comp X. Q plus trimethyl amine gives Y. Q plus copper chloride gives Z plus cuprous chloride. Okay, here one more point they are given. X is the monoanion having the pyramidal geometry. Both Y and Z are neutral compounds. I think we are using regularly 2 tin chlorides. What they are? Stannous chloride, SN plus 2, and stannic chloride, that is SN plus 4. Okay, among the options, only one hint is available, that is third statement you can identify, that Q plus copper chloride converted into Z plus cuprous chloride, means copper plus 2 converted into copper plus 1, that indicates copper undergoes reduction. Definitely Q undergoes oxidation. You observe that now, tin plus 2 available, tin plus 4 available. I think we know very well, tin maximum oxidation number plus 4. That means, suppose I will take the Q as a stannic chloride, there is no way to undergo further oxidation of the Q. In that way, stannic chloride is eliminated. Definitely I will take the stannous chloride. This stannous chloride now allowed to react with the copper chloride and giving stannic chloride plus cuprous chloride. Now you will identify that tin plus 2, 2 plus 4 oxidation, copper plus 2 to plus 1 reduction. Okay, surely we can say that it is a stannous chloride. Okay, we got the compound, that is the Q. Q is the stannous chloride. Now, based on that data, we can find one by one that options. Now, beginning that they are giving that now, oxidation state of the central atom in Z is plus 2. It is wrong. You can identify that. Z is the stannic chloride, tin is plus 4. That's why option 1 is wrong. You can eliminate the option 1. Now, coming to the option 2. Central atom in the Z has one lone pair of electrons. You can identify that. Tin, it is the 4 bonds are there like this, we know very well, no lone pairs, it is a tetrahedral molecule. That means there is no lone pair on the central atom. Okay, that's why option 2 also wrong. Coming to the option 3, central atom in X is sp3 hybridized. X means this one only. Stannous chloride plus chloride ion converted into one anion. That anion mostly you are taking like this, tin, and one lone pair is there, chlorine, chlorine, chlorine. Yes, here this tin using the sp3 hybridization, due to the presence of one lone pair, it is a pyramidal geometry. That's why third option what they are given, that is correct one. Just like ammonia molecule, it is also pyramidal. Tin is the sp3 hybridization. Reason, 3 bond pairs are there, 1 lone pair is there. Okay, in that way you will take it now. Coming to the last one, state option. That is the coordinate bond present in Y. Coordinate bond means you know very well, stannous chloride works as a Lewis acid. In this case, it is having ability to work as a Lewis base also, but here lone pair is available on the trimethyl amine, that is why it works as a Lewis base. Now, trimethyl amine donates electron pair, nothing but we call it as a contributing and accepting the stannous chloride. That means here day 2 bond is present. Okay, what statement, what option given in the last one, that is also correct. Okay, finally we conclude that this is a very good question given from the inorganic chemistry. Only the thing, the best statement they are given in this, that is the Q plus copper chloride gives rise to Z plus copper chloride. And tin chlorides maximum used, chlorides only 2, in that way easily we can find it, that is stannous chloride. Okay, anyhow, finally we conclude. In this question, 3 option and 4th option, these 2 only correct. Another question given from the general chemistry, it is a very good question. Identify the correct option where all 4 molecules having permanent dipole at room temperature. Okay, first I will select what molecules are having permanent dipole, what molecules not having permanent dipole. How you can decide? You can take the net dipole. Net dipole is equal to 0, means no permanent dipole. How you can decide that? Example, boron trifluoride BF3 molecule you will take. Here bond movements, you can identify that. And from the central atom, all the bond movements are moving away from the central atom. That's why all are cancelled to each other. That means dipole moment, net dipole moment value, it is equal to 0. That's why no permanent dipole in the BF3 molecule. Otherwise, better to take the example beryllium chloride. Here beryllium chloride, from the beryllium atom to chlorine, this movement is there like this. Another bond movement is there from beryllium to chlorine. How can you decide bond movement? Bond movement is there from less electronegative atom to more electronegative atom. Now, it is a linear molecule, beryllium chloride. This chlorine moves away from the central atom, another chlorine exactly moves away in opposite direction. Net dipole moment equal to 0, these molecules are called nonpolar molecules. And one more thing, these are also called symmetrical molecules. Here, and BF3, sulfur hexafluoride, beryllium chloride, carbon dioxide, BCl3, these are not having permanent dipole. You will check it now. Option 1, they want all the 4 molecules having permanent dipole. But you will take the example, option 1, BF3 is there, dipole moment, it is net dipole moment equal to 0. Okay, that's why BF3 net dipole moment equal to 0. Ozone, bent molecule, net dipole moment not equal to 0. It is a bent molecule, not cancel the bond moments exactly to each other. The best example for the nonpolar covalent bonds are present, but it is a polar molecule because of net dipole moment not equal to 0. Sulfur hexafluoride just only completed, that means net dipole moment equal to 0. Xenon hexafluoride, you know very well, it is having distorted octahedral geometry. That's why distorted octahedral geometry means you are assuming like this here, almost. Here bond moments are not exactly cancelled to each other. That's why mu net value not equal to 0. In this option, boron trifluoride, sulfur hexafluoride. These two molecules net dipole moment equal to 0, whereas ozone, xenon hexafluoride, net dipole moment not equal to 0. But they want all 4 molecules having permanent dipole, that's why option 1 don't take. Coming to the nitrogen dioxide, nitrogen dioxide and second option. Now we are going to second option. In this second option, nitrogen dioxide is there. Everyone knowing it is a bent molecule. That's why net dipole moment not equal to 0 means permanent dipole is there. Ammonia, we know very well, net dipole not equal to 0. Reason, it is a pyramidal molecule, this one. Lone pair movement is there away from the central atom. Hydrogen to nitrogen movement is there like this, but anyhow not cancelled to each other. That's why net dipole moment not equal to 0. POCl3, phosphorus oxychloride. Here, it is a tetrahedral molecule. No lone pair is there on the central atom, but central atom surrounded by different kind of atoms. So that's why all the movements are not exactly cancelled to each other. That is the reason only mu net not equal to 0. Just like this one, methyl chloride. It is also central atom not having any lone pair, but the central atom is surrounded by different kind of atoms, so all the bond moments are not exactly cancelled to each other. That's why mu net it not equal to 0. That means in option 2, nitrogen dioxide, ammonia, phosphorus oxychloride, methyl chloride all having net dipole. That's why these are called unsymmetrical molecules. Now, this what they want exactly present here. All the four molecules are having permanent dipole. That's why second option is correct. Coming to the third option. In the third option, sulfur dioxide, it is a bent molecule, we know very well. That's why net dipole not equal to 0. Chlorobenzene, that's why net dipole not equal to 0. That's it is having permanent dipole. Hydrogen selenide, it is also bent molecule, just like water molecule. That's why net dipole not equal to 0. I think you know very well here bromine pentafluoride. You know very well it is a distorted square pyramidal. Here also net dipole not equal to 0. That means in option 3, sulfur dioxide, bent molecule, net dipole is there. Chlorobenzene, net dipole not equal to 0. Hydrogen selenide, just like water, it is also bent molecule, not equal to 0. Bromine pentafluoride, it is a distorted square pyramidal. Distorted square pyramidal means net dipole not equal to 0. Okay, now option 3 is correct one. Now in option 4, beryllium chloride net dipole equal to 0, carbon dioxide net dipole equal to 0, BCl3 net dipole equal to 0, chloroform net dipole not equal to 0. That means here all the four molecules, I mean, not having permanent dipole, that's why last option also don't take. Finally, we conclude that in this one, net dipole is there in the second option, all the four molecules are having the net dipole, and in the third option, all the four molecules are having net dipole. Okay, another question in this section given from the physical chemistry, that is states of matter. The question itself is the correct option regarding RMS velocity of the molecule in a gas at equilibrium. We know one thing, kinetic energy, average kinetic energy or kinetic energy per molecule, it is equal to 3/2 kT. And kinetic energy per molecule means it is independent of the mass of the molecule or gas. Because of kinetic energy per molecule determined, here 3 by 2 kT, it is equal to 3 by 2 kT. Here mass term not there. That means K is the Boltzmann's constant, T is the absolute temperature. Now, kinetic energy at given temperature does not depend on its molecular weight, Yes, it is correct because of no mass term in the average kinetic energy. And the second statement, RMS velocity is inversely proportional to square root of its molecular weight. Yes, correct, everyone knowing RMS velocity equal to root over 3RT by M. 3RT by M means here RMS velocity inversely proportional to molecular weight, square root of its molecular weight. That's why second statement also correct. Next, RMS velocity doubled when temperature is increased 4 times. You know one thing, RMS velocity directly proportional to square root of its temperature. That's why 4 times this temperature increased means RMS velocity doubled because of that two are related to one and another. RMS velocity directly proportional to square root of its absolute temperature. That's why third statement also correct. Next one, kinetic average kinetic energy is doubled when its temperature is increased 4 times. No, because of kinetic energy equal to 3 by 2 kT. Okay, that means directly proportional to each other. Directly proportional to each other means this last statement is wrong. Finally, we conclude that here average kinetic energy at a given temperature does not depend on its molecular mass is correct. URMS inversely proportional to square root of its molecular weight correct. URMS doubled when temperature is increased 4 times correct. Last one is average kinetic energy doubled when its temperature is increased 4 times is wrong. As per the formulas we can determine easily, it is the easiest question. They are given from the states of matter, it is a physical chemistry question. Okay, this question in the section 2 given from the physical chemistry, that is our best chapter, that is a nuclear chemistry. And many times one question given in JEE advance from the nuclear chemistry, and they are given one process 92 uranium 238 X1 emitted, and then 90 thorium 234 obtained, and X2 emitted, 91 protactitium 234 obtained, again X3 emitted, Z234 obtained, next X4 emitted, 90 thorium 230 is obtained. Okay, here X1, X2, X3, X4 are particles or radiation. Radiation nothing but energy emitted by respective isotopes. Now we can find the correct option. Okay, just you can identify that 92 uranium 238 and it is converted into 90 thorium 234. Two units atomic number decreased, 4 units mass number decreased. It is nothing but alpha particle, means 2 alpha particle 4. That means x1 is equal to alpha particle. And next, mass number no change, but atomic number 1 unit increased. Okay, we know very well, 90 thorium 234 to 91 protactitium 234 here, only no change in the mass number, only atomic number 1 unit increased, means it is a beta particle, and beta particle emitted, that means x2 is equal to, just we will take it now, beta particle. No change in the mass number, only atomic number 1 unit increased. Now we are going to find the x3 and x4. Small problem is there in the case of x3. Here, from the previous nucleide to Z 234 obtained, but here atomic number they are not mentioned. But next step you will take it now. 90 thorium 230. Here, better, in the third step, 234 to 234, mass number no change, but last step, 234 to 230, 4 units mass number decreased. I think alpha particle emitted. Here atomic number 90 is there, that means previous element to atomic number 92. In that way we will take it here, that means 92 and Z 234 to 90 thorium 230 is obtained. Here this step is related to x of 4. Now this again you will take that now, alpha particle, that means alpha particle means x 4 equal to alpha particle. Step 3 also we want to find it. Now based on that we got the this Z value, that Z is the atomic number 92, that means I will take like this here. Now step 3 is related to Pa 234 to 92 uranium 234. Here no change in the mass number, atomic number 1 unit increased, means it is also beta particle. That's why step 3, x3 is equal to beta particle. Now we got the all the particles, x1 is alpha particle, x2 is the beta particle, x3 also beta particle, x4 alpha particle. Okay, we got it all. Now we can find that option 1, Z is the isotope of uranium, yes, correct. It is the Z is the 92 uranium 234, it is the isotope of 92 uranium 238, that's why option 1 is correct. Now x1 deflect towards negatively charged plate, x1 is the alpha particle, alpha particle is a positively charged particle. That's why it is attracted towards the negatively charged particle plate. That means second option also correct. And X3 is gamma ray, they are given. No, it is the beta particle. It is not the gamma radiation. Gamma radiation means energy radiation, means no change in the atomic number and mass numbers. Only energies are rearranged. That means third option is wrong. Last option, X2 is the beta particle. Beta particle is a negatively charged particle. That means X2 is the beta particle, they are given. Yes, correct. X2 means this step, here beta particle emitted. Okay, finally we conclude that here X1 is the alpha particle, X2 is the beta particle, X3 is the beta particle, X4 is the alpha particle. Okay, based on this data we can conclude that option 1 correct, option 2 correct, and option 4 is correct. Only third option is wrong. Okay, very good question they are given from the nuclear chemistry. It is the easiest chapter. I think most of the students attempted this question correctly. Okay, we are going to the another section, decimal integer type questions. After decimal, 2 digits are required in this section. Now, it is the question given from the physical chemistry, that is chemical equilibrium. Kc value given for the particular reaction. Now, in this iron plus 2 sulfide ion converted into iron sulfide, FeS, ferrous sulfide. It is a solid. Solid active mass 1. Iron plus 2 concentration given, sulfide ion concentration given. But the two concentrations of solutions having the equal volumes, now equal volumes of the with certain concentrations of iron plus 2 and sulfide solutions combined, and then they want to find the equilibrium concentration of iron plus 2, that is reported as a y into 10 power minus 17 molar. Now I want to find the value of y. I think everyone knowing concentration and volume inversely proportional. That means volume doubled means concentration becomes half of the that initial concentration. That means here iron plus 2 concentration they are given, sulfide ion concentration given, iron plus 2 initial concentration 0.06 molar, sulfide concentration 0.2 molar. That means equal volumes of these two solutions combined means the resultant concentration of iron plus 2 0.03 molar, sulfide ion concentration 0.1 molar. Because of equal volumes of these two solutions combined, concentration becomes a half. That's why only iron plus 2 0.03 molar, sulfide ion 0.01 molar. Okay, after combining that two solutions, concentrations taken 0.03 molar, 0.01 molar. Okay, anyhow, iron sulfide means ferrous sulfide, that active mass 1, no need to apply it. Okay, here iron plus 2 almost 0.03 molar reacting and convert into products, and from the sulfide ion concentration also 0.03 molar concentration reacted as per stoichiometric coefficients. That's why the remained concentrations at equilibrium, sulfide ion 0.07 because of 0.03 deducted from the 0.1 molar as per stoichiometric reaction. Really, iron plus 2, as per the statement what we said, 0.03 molar reacted, but 0.03 molar reacted means it is meaningless because of we are there at equilibrium. That means certain concentration is there, that value is a very very less, that is why only I will take it X concentration. Now that X concentration is there after combining of these two solutions with respect to iron plus 2, sulfide ion concentration 0.07. We know very well, now Kc equal to its active mass 1 products, that is why no need. Iron plus 2 concentration, it is a reactant. Sulfide ion concentration, it is also reactant. Already Kc value they are given here, that is introducing here now, and sulfide ion concentration introducing, and iron plus 2 calculated, then we are getting that now 8.9285 after rounding off and truncating off the result 8.93 molar. This is the answer for this question, decimal integer type question. It is very, I think, mostly easily given. Only one small key point is there, that is only the thing. Here iron plus 2 almost reacted, but it is a chemical, it is a equilibrium, definitely certain amount is remained back, but that value is very very less, but I mean don't keep the 0 here, it is meaningless because of it is equilibrium. Anyhow, it is a very good question given from the equilibrium. Another question in the integer, decimal integer type questions. It is given from the inorganic chemistry, that is group 18 elements. Okay. At a given temperature, xenon tetrafluoride reacts with the dioxin difluoride, produces xenon compound Y. Total number of lone pairs of electrons on the whole molecule Y is. I think this reaction we want to write it here, xenon tetrafluoride and dioxin difluoride. Then it gives xenon hexafluoride plus O2. Now why is this hexafluoride? I think everyone knowing here xenon, really geometry of the xenon hexafluoride is distorted octahedral, but I am not representing the geometry here, just bonding only I can represent here, it is not the geometry. And here xenon still having one lone pair of electrons after formation of the bonds with the fluorine atoms. But you know very well, each fluorine can form the one bond, still having each fluorine having three lone pairs of electrons. That means, like each fluorine, three lone pair of electrons are there, means here you know very well, and like six fluorine atoms are available, and 6 into 3 lone pairs 18. Now total 19 lone pairs of electrons are there. They are asking you total number of lone pairs of electrons on the whole molecule, not only central atom. Whole molecule means xenon hexafluoride taken. Here I am not representing the geometry of the molecule, just bonding represented. Okay, finally, from the each xenon atom, one lone pair available, from the fluorine atoms 18 lone pairs available, total 19 lone pairs available. You can report this answer as 19.00. After decimal, two digits you can represent it. Anyhow, this question easily you can find it, and very good question they are given. Another decimal integer type question given from the physical chemistry, that is chemical kinetics. Here kinetic data given for the particular reaction, and concentration of A, concentration of B, concentration of C. With respect to that concentrations, rate of the that reaction also provided. Like total 4 experiments completed. After that, rate of reaction they want with the another concentrations of A, B and C. And that rate they are reported as a y into 10 power minus 5 mole per dm cube per second. I want to find the value of y. What we can do? Here by isolation method, beginning I want to find the rate of reaction using this data. That is why I am preparing that now, one equation. Rate equation equal to k into a power x, b power y, c power z. You can identify that isolation method means what? You can take that now. I want to determine the order with respect to the concentration term b. For that case, what I will do? Experiment 1, and you will take it now. Concentrations of A, B, C available, related to rate also available. Experiment 2, concentration of A not changed, concentration of B only changed, concentration of the C not changed. That method itself is called isolation method. Here one reactant only changed, then rate not changed. Here easily we can find from 1 and 2 experiments with respect to concentration term B, the order equal to 0. In the same way, you can determine the orders with respect to C. Same technique we are using that now. That is why from 1 and 3 with respect to concentration term C, the order equal to 1. Same technique you are using in the case of A, and from the experiment 1 and 4, and this order with respect to reactant term A, that is also 1. Now anyhow, finally the order we determined here, that is the rate equal to k into A power 1, B power 0, C power 1. Overall order is 2. With respect to reactant A, 1 with respect to B0 with respect to C1. Now, anyhow, order determined. Using this rate equation, I want to find the rate constant K. Any data you are taken here, suppose experiment 1, concentration of A, concentration of B, concentration of C, corresponding rate is available using this K value determined. What is the advantage of determination of the value of K? K value, once determined for the given rate of reaction, that value not affected by changing of concentration, because of the value of K independent of concentration. Anyhow, K value determined. Using this K value, again they are giving the concentrations of A, B, C. Using that value of K, already order determined, and again you can introduce that rate equation, rate equal to K into A power 1, B power 0, C power 1. Now, concentration of A they are provided now, and that is the concentration of A 0.15, concentration of B 0.25, and concentration of C 0.15. All that values introducing, K value already we got it, and rate determined, and as per the given value of this Y equal to 6.75. This is the final answer and as per the given data. I think here only one key point involved, that is the first you can find the order of the reaction using the data, and then you can determine the value of K. Using of that value of K, again you can determine the rate of reaction. Okay. This is the question given from the chemical kinetics. Okay, another question in the decimal integer type questions in this one. This question given from the physical chemistry, that is from the solutions. Okay, certain weight of non-volatile non-ionic solute dissolved in the 39 grams of benzene. Then its vapor pressure decreased, and then they want depression of the freezing point of benzene. Here solvent is benzene, solute is non-volatile, non-ionic. That means you can take that it is an ideal solution. Ideal solution means here I value is equal to 1. How do you say like that? They are giving that non-volatile, non-ionic solute. No ionization, no association of that solute. Here initially weight of the solute given, weight of the solvent also given. P naught indicates the vapor pressure of the pure solvent, Ps indicates the vapor pressure of the solution containing non-volatile solute. Then P naught minus Ps by Ps equal to moles of the solute by moles of the solvent. P naught indicates vapor pressure of the solvent, Ps indicates vapor pressure of the solution. Now that values they are given and introducing in this, moles of the solute calculated, and then they want the delta TF value. Delta TF equal to IKFM. I value is 1 because of it is an ideal solution. KF value they have provided because of here benzene is the solvent. Molality means you know very well, moles of the solute into 1000 by weight of the solvent. After calculation you will get the approximately 1.03. I think mostly this value is taken. Okay, 1.03 is here, take it as answer, otherwise you will take that here 1.022 1.03. I think mostly acceptable value is the 1.022 1.03. Okay, anyhow, it is this question I think easily you can calculate, and as per the given data, only one thing, using the beginning data you can calculate the moles of the solute, and then you will calculate the delta TF. Delta TF means depression of the freezing point of benzene. This question given from the inorganic chemistry. Here some molecules are given and they want total number of molecules containing the bond between the same kind of atoms. How many are there? We want to find it. I think diborane, here there is no bond between the same kind of atoms, that is why it is not taken. Borazine, here also there is no bond between the same kind of atoms, that is why do not take. Nitrous oxide, nitrous oxide, here nitrogen, nitrogen, here bond is there, same kind of atoms, you will take that. And dinitrogen tetraoxide, here also bond is there between the same kind of atoms, and another one, here bond is there between the same kind of atoms, H2S2O3, and peroxydisulfuric acid, here also bond is there between the same kind of atoms. In this way, here diborane not there and borazine also not there, whereas nitrous oxide, say the bond is there between same kind of atoms, dinitrogen tetraoxide, it is also containing the bond between the same kind of atoms, and thiosulfuric acid H2S2O3, thiosulfuric acid, it is also containing the bond between the same kind of atoms. And peroxydisulfuric acid, here also the bond is there between the same kind of atoms. In this way, here total 4 molecules containing the bond between the same kind of atoms. Okay, last question in the paper 1, in the decimal integer type questions. This question given from the organic chemistry, they are given total 3 steps of the processes given, they are naming as an A, schemes 1, 2, 3 given. Okay, finally what they want, total number of bromine atoms in the molecule of T, they want it. Okay, they are giving that now scheme 1. Aniline is a starting compound and some reagents they are added, Q is the major product. Scheme 2, benzene given, that they are named as R, some reagents they are added and a major product is the S. Scheme 3 given and S now added by sodium hydroxide, what we got it, Q in the scheme 1 that is added. Finally, the compound T is obtained. Okay, initially aniline is taken, it is added by the bromine excess taken in the presence of the polar solvent. Everyone knowing it is an ES reaction. Electrophile is attacking on the aniline. NH2 group is a highly activating group and it is conducted in the presence of the polar solvent water. That's why not only para position, ortho position is also attacked by bromine. Tribromo aniline is obtained. Now it is subjecting to diazotization. NH2 group converted into this diazo group. Now diazo compound is obtained. Now it is added by the copper cyanide in the presence of potassium cyanide. It is a Sandmeyer's reaction. N2 group replaced by cyanide. That's why cyano group is obtained in this compound. Now it is undergoing the acid hydrolysis. Cyanide is converted into carboxylic group. Now it is reacting with the thionyl chloride. Everyone knowing carboxylic group converted into acid halide group. Okay, finally Q compound is the this one. Three bromine atoms are there, one acid halide group is there. Okay, scheme 1 is completed. Now we are going to the scheme 2. Now benzene is added by oleum. Oleum means it is a highly concentrated sulfuric acid, H2S2O7. Here sulfonic group is introduced. Now this sulfonic group is excellent leaving group. Now it is replaced by OH group, and but it is an alkali medium, that's why only again acidification completed. Then phenol is obtained. Now phenol is added by bromine in the presence of carbon disulfide. It is also EAS reaction, means bromine electrophile coming and attacking the phenol. OH group is also activating group, but problem is the here solvent is the carbon disulfide, non-polar solvent. That's why mostly bromine is attacking at the para position of this OH group. That's why para bromo phenol is obtained, that is named as a S compound. Now we are going to scheme 3. Para bromo phenol now treated with the sodium hydroxide, then this OH group is acid group we know, and converted into para bromo phenoxide ion. I think this ring is highly activated. Under that conditions, this O minus working as a nucleophile. That's why Q is means this one. Here acid halide is there. Now from that acid halide group, chloride is replaced by this phenoxide ion. Finally this T compound is obtained, that is this one. Finally the T compound is obtained, that is a major product. Here bromine, total how many bromine atoms are there? 1, 2, 3, 4 bromine atoms are there. Okay, anyhow here final product total 4 bromine atoms are there. Okay, this question also only the thing number of steps involved, but one by one we concluded that finally we get the answer easily. But last step is only that reaction is the phenoxide ion working as a nucleophile, and here acid halide is available. That's why that chlorine is replaced by this phenoxide ion. Okay, anyhow finally paper 1 completed. I think that may help you to get the best score in all competitive examinations where the chemistry is present. Anyhow, once again, Good luck to the all JEE aspirants.